Are you ready to say goodbye to the constant ups and downs of the artist income roller coaster? Whether you're a full-time artist who wants to increase and stabilize your income, a part-time musician who wants to go full-time, or a hobbyist who needs to fund your passion projects, this podcast will equip you with the tools, resources, and inspiration to make it happen. My name is Bree Noble. I'm a musician, best-selling author, and educator whose mission is to help musicians like you to increase the income you're already making and tap into new income streams so you can create a more diverse, stable, reliable income from music and finally ditch the starving artist mentality. Now let's dive into the Profitable Musician Show. Hey everyone, this is Bree Noble, and I'm excited to be on the podcast today with Breana Marin. And we're going to be talking about her story and her music and how she has managed to get a lot of licensing deals. So I think this is going to be really interesting to you guys, especially those who've been interested in getting into licensing and in a different ways that you can go about it. So before we get into that, Breana, I would love to know more about your background, how you got into music, and just a little bit about your story up until now.
Okay, so I am a songwriter at heart. That's what I do since the beginning of time. I moved to LA, didn't really know songwriting was a thing that you could get paid for. So I went to a Musicians Institute, ended up linking up with a professional songwriter at the time who was like, at the height of his career. His name is Andre Mara. He had written for like Disturbia, written Forever for Chris Brown. He's having a really great year at about the time I was out there. So I interned for him, learned as much as I could from him, and then kind of like blossomed out into my own thing and started writing for other artists. So I've written for Fifth Harmony, Keisha Cole. I've written for Star and Empire on Fox, among other television shows. And then I'd somehow got entangled with the online world of music. It started on a website called Sound Better, where I don't know if you've heard of it, but Sound Better is basically a place where engineers, producers, songwriters, vocalists can be hired by clients looking for someone that they need to help finish their songs or like whatever project that they're working on. So that was a life changer. I was able to buy myself out of my publishing situation that I was in and just kind of move on from there. And then I met the owner and founder of Beatstars, who was telling me what all these producers were doing on Beatstars, which they license beats. So they make one beat and license it thousands of times to different customers with different terms and conditions, depending on like the price of the license. So at the time there wasn't very many songwriters doing it. It was mostly just producers. So I started partnering with producers on the platform and licensing hooks, like just hooks to songwriters. And it's like, there's like a huge audience of songwriters and rappers who love having the pre-made hooks on the track. So yeah, that's my story, like quickly as possible summed up.
That I'm really interested to talk about this because I have heard of Sound Better and Beatstars from my friend Chris Bradley, who teaches people how to produce from home. And I think the biggest question that I get around this is like, they think that beats are just about hip hop. Can you explain a little bit more of like what a beat is?
Yeah, everybody needs a beat, you know? I think like, let's just start there. Like, if you want to write a song, we're going to need a beat or a track or chords or whatever it is that inspires you to start writing your song. So on Beatstars, there is a massive hip hop community, of course. I would say hip hop producers are the ones that are probably getting the most shine because a lot of, I think like Soulja Boy bought some tracks off of Beatstars and like Lil Nas X, I can't remember the name of the song that he had that was so huge. It was like kind of like a country sounding song.
Old Town Road. Yeah.
Yes. He bought that on Beatstars.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. So in the hip hop world, it's definitely a massive, massive thing, but there is a whole world of like pop producers on there. And there are other people who specialize in different things like sound kits. And some people sell chords and just like, there's a plethora of things you can get on Beatstars. So yeah, a beat for me in my songwriting process is the starting place. It would have the full thing going on, drums, chords, special little elements, and then probably divided up into sections like verse, hook, verse, bridge, whatever you need.
So it's almost, I mean, it's kind of like an
anything from like a loop to an arrangement is the way I'm kind of thinking of it as, because I know that, you know, some people in my world like to do orchestral stuff and they're like, is what I'm doing beats?
Technically, because in my, like in my dictionary, if you were to ask me, I feel like a beat is anything that is just like a complete arranged composition that maybe doesn't have vocals on it.
Okay.
Yeah. But okay. Traditionally, I would say probably not orchestral. I would probably refer to that as like a track or an instrumental or like an instrumental piece. But on Beatstars, yeah. Beats, I would say definitely EDM, pop, hip hop, like all of those kind of commercial genres, beats all day.
Got it. Okay. That's super helpful because I want our audience to know what we're talking about here when we're talking about this. So when you license a beat on there, I'm assuming you've had this happen where you have one beat and it's being licensed out to multiple people. When you hear the finished product, are you like, these sound really similar? Or you're like, wow, I can't believe how different these are starting from the same beat.
I would say none of them sound the same. And it's very interesting. Yeah, none of them sound the same. Some of them are incredible and like blow me away. Some of them, I'm like, okay, I would love to hear you try again and like do it differently. But like, but for the most part, people are pretty talented. And some people write me and they'll say like, they don't intend on releasing it commercially, but like hearing the actual hook inspired them to tell some kind of story. So they just wanted to like have the little therapy session to just write whatever they were feeling because that prompted them to feel some kind of way. So yeah, there's a lot of different reasons people like the beats with hooks.
Interesting. So when they license the beat, they're paying you like right then for that, whatever they do with it at that point, you're getting paid. But what if they do release it? Do they have to ask your permission?
So the platform is set up, like it's pretty intuitive how it's set up. So when you go to our beat store is what it's called, like your profile is technically your beat store. So like your whole catalog is available there for people to kind of like go through and see what they like. When they purchase something, you can have options. It's your world. You can like set it up however you want. So I typically have four options. You can get a basic license, a premium license, an unlimited license. And then sometimes there's an exclusive license, which means I will not sell this to anybody but you. I don't really do that often. But like the basic license is probably just like the MP3. So like you're paying like $20, you're going to get the MP3, and then you have like a limited amount of rights with the song. You know what I mean? It might be like, you can't release the song commercially and like make money or something like that. It varies like what the license actually says. The unlimited one is the one that I typically recommend to everyone, which means like you buy it probably like $200 to $500. You'll get the whole, like a track out with all the individual stems. So like you'll be able to customize the track the way you want to customize it because it'll have the individual piano export, the drum export, my vocal export, like all of the things in the track, so you can kind of have the freedom to do it whatever you want to do. And then there's no limitations on how you utilize the track commercially. So yeah, that's typically like, as soon as they buy it, they'll get the license delivered and they can see what they're allowed to do based on that.
That's really cool and really customizable. I really like that. So I run a course on releasing music. And this question came up just the other day in our conversation in our live call. And I know many of you listening might already know the answer to this, but I'm going to ask it here just to make sure that everyone listening, we're all on the same page. Can you explain what stems are?
I'm trying to think of like a simple way to explain stems.
That's what I was always trying to figure out on the call. I was like, how can I explain this?
It's so hard, but I would say if we have our beat, so we all kind of have the understanding now of like what a beat is, it's typically what the producer creates that we're going to write to. So the beat, when the producer makes it, he probably used, let's say he used five different instruments. And so that would mean he has five different tracks in his actual session that he created the beat in. So stems are the exports of those individual instruments that are on the song. So if there's a piano, a bass, a drum, synths, cymbals, hi-hats, whatever, All of those individual instruments are going to be exported as WAV files, and those are the track stems. And then it allows you or your engineer to go back into the session and customize it the way you would want to customize it for your project.
That was a great way of explaining it. Just to clarify, these are the fully processed files, right? They're not the raw files.
Well, it varies. Some producers will have a folder that say dry stems and then wet stems. So they give you the option to customize, but not all of them do that. Some of them do only do the wet processed stems.
Right. Because if you're using it for licensing, for example, TV and film, they might want to like change the levels of certain things, and they don't want to have to go and like reprocess the files.
Right. Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, this is great. I appreciate you like educating our audience, because I think there's a lot of, especially in my audience, there's a lot of people that don't know about this stuff, and it can really inspire them that they're like, there's other ways that they can use music that they already have. I know when I talked to Chris, I had her on the show a few weeks ago and we talked about some of this, and she's like, so many people don't know about this way to license music. So how... I know you were also releasing your own music as well. So, and you mentioned that you were like a featured artist on like a ton of tracks on Spotify because of the fact that you sell these beats. Do you find that that's helping your Spotify numbers?
Absolutely. I feel like it's like having a grassroots campaign for myself, just because it starts with that one listener going to my beat store and releasing something. And now I'm automatically exposed to their listeners. And some of them might only have a few, and then some of them might have thousands that I never would have, you know, been able to be exposed to. And even the ones that have a few, it's like, they might only have a few, but that one person they exposed me to is like a diehard, you know, like listener now who always wants to go and get everything that I have. So I would say, yeah, it's helped me tremendously. The only downside would be when I release music, sometimes I'm competing against everybody else releasing music with my name on it as well. So, you know, it's like it gets buried on my little profile. Right. But overall, I would say it's helped more than it's hurt.
Now, are they required to name you as basically a featured artist on the track?
Yeah, it's listed in the license to credit me and the producer of the track appropriately, like by saying featured, and then also say like putting us in the PRO information, like ASCAP, BMI, any publishing, like however you're doing it, like we need to be credited appropriately.
Got it. And the cool thing on Spotify is if you do that correctly, you can click on the name and it goes straight to your profile, right? Yes. Mm-hmm. Which is really cool. I've definitely found stuff that way.
Oh yeah, me too, for sure.
Yeah, so this is interesting because I did have someone on here a while back. We were talking about collabs and how much collabs had helped her get new audiences. And I'm assuming it works the same way with this for you.
Oh yeah, I would say collaboration has been the key to like everything for me, especially starting, I mean, even going back to Sound Better, because it's like pretty much, I would say if we were on my Spotify profile right now, the funny thing is the top played song on there is actually a Sound Better project.
Wow.
yeah. So definitely collaboration has been wonderful for me.
Yeah, I think, and yeah, it's interesting because we were talking before, right, about whether you have control over whether they're releasing something and maybe you don't like the product, right? And what happens if somehow that gets to be like the top thing on your Spotify list of your, you know, top five songs? There's not really anything you can do about that.
No, there's not at all. Right. That could be a downside, I guess.
Yeah, it's a trade-off.
Yeah, I'm like, yeah, you win some, you lose some. But it definitely happens, for sure.
Definitely. Okay, well, I'm assuming that what we just said about, you know, collabs and stuff, that's really helped your career. And is that kind of how you started your licensing company, is that you just really wanted to help other artists?
Yeah, I was. So something else that was happening is I was doing speaking engagements and stuff with Beatstars. So other songwriters were hearing about like what I was doing, and they all had like a lot of questions. So then then your DMs and your emails become filled with like, what should I do? How do I do it? How can I be a part of it? What is like, you know, like, what's the plan? And so that was in the back of my head of like, okay, there's all these writers that and producers that are like exposing themselves to me. And then also I have projects going on that I sometimes I can't humanly complete all of the things, you know what I mean? By myself. So that's kind of where it all stemmed from. And then naturally, my peers around me, I was already collaborating heavily, like with a certain group of people. And so it just became like, oh, why don't we just, you know, why is this not just an actual entity that we have? So that's pretty much where it stemmed from.
Okay. And what's the name of your licensing company?
Love Pulse Music.
Love Pulse Music. Love it. And so are you guys all, you know, kind of working together in the company, or do you have a team that's like representing all of you?
Yeah. So we're all working together. There is like a small admin team that like they deal with all of the scientific things that artists do not like to deal with or talk about.
All the contracts and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. All that stuff. That's like when everybody's like, no, it's okay.
Or maintaining the massive catalog in Excel or wherever you're keeping.
Yeah, definitely. That's me. And then like a group of like administrative kind of people that we take care of all that other stuff. And then the artists are just artists. We created a platform for them to be able to communicate with each other easily and share files and all that kind of stuff. So they write together, they work together. You know, that's where we share all of like our TV briefs and stuff like that. So it's a nice little community. It's been cool, especially during like the pandemic, to have like a whole group of people to be able to, you know, still exchange energy with and create things with.
Definitely. We all need that. And it's encouraging to everyone. So do you guys accept other artists, or is it just kind of this closed collective?
It's a small boutique collective, but we do accept outside artists. But it's not like something that we don't take them like in the masses. We like it to be very curated and intentional. So if a gym shows up, then yes, we definitely take that person in.
Right. But you're not like putting it out with Taxi or something like that, looking for people.
No. Mm-mm.
Cool. So yeah, I love all of this. I think it's going to be super educational for artists. Are there any other platforms that you use to license your own, you know, beats and collab other than Sound Better and Beatstars?
Those two for a long time were like my main bread and butter. I also simultaneously created my own website that also became like a hub for everything. Anyone that found me on those random websites would definitely make their way over to my main hub. I also do sound kits. So the other platforms I use are like dedicated sound kit platforms, like Sounds and Splice. I've done kits for Output and stuff like that. So that's the other thing. I license my vocals for those kind of things as well.
Wow. There's so many ways to go about making income these days online. It's pretty incredible.
Absolutely.
So what's exciting that's going on in your, I'm assuming you're also pursuing your own music career as an artist.
Yeah. So I do like a whole slew of things, and because I focus so much on TV and film, I have like a large catalog of music. So lately I've been going through those catalogs and grouping together the songs that I feel like this is an album, you know? So I have like two or three of those that are not simultaneous, but probably one after the other going to be coming out. And the first one is called Songs About Us. And I wrote it around, like, obviously a time of a breakup. So it's very dramatic. I made it with the person that I was in the relationship with. So it was very interesting process. It was a very interesting process. At the same time, I think because of that process, we're able to like be friends, and you know, we were able to get all of our feelings out in a like productive way. So I think that was very, very helpful. But I look at my artist stuff not as like, I'm definitely not trying to be like Beyonce, like touring and like doing all of those things. I like releasing music, so it's available if it's on a TV show. It's available for the listener that may have heard it. And B, it's like merch for me. It's like, you know what I mean? It's like another piece of the million things that I create and license. Yeah. So that's pretty much where my head is at with like releasing music, is I love there to be like a body of work that kind of represents what's going on in my life at that moment.
That's very cool. So if you were to give some advice to somebody that's kind of at the beginning of all of this, they're thinking about getting into this online licensing world, what advice would you give them?
I would say research before you start. take a look at who's performing the best on those platforms and take what you can from it and apply it to yourself. If possible, have a home set up so that you can just be lightning fast with your work. Mm-hmm. And then I would say create and then market as much as you possibly can.
Sounds like a good plan for sure. Awesome. Well, how can people find you online and check out all of your cool beats and, you know, Spotify and all that, all the places?
I would say the quickest and easiest way to find me is to go to briannamarin.com. I have links to everywhere in all of the things that I have going on. My Instagram is @itsbriannamarin. And also there is a link there that will lead you to all of the wonderful places and things that you can go with me.
Perfect. Perfect. Well, we will put those in our show notes. Thank you so much. And I appreciate you, you know, while telling your story, also educating our audience on some of this. I know it's going to be really helpful for them.
Yes, thanks for having me.
Thanks for listening to The Profitable Musician Show. I would love to know your takeaways and aha moments from this episode. Leave me a comment over at profitablemusician.com so I can bring you more of the information, interviews, and resources that you love. Thanks to Rondi Fay, one of my Academy members, for providing the music for our podcast. You can check her out at rondifay.com. That's RANDIFAY.com. Just remember, knowledge is power, but without implementation, it is useless. And inspiration without action is merely entertainment. But I know you're not just a dreamer, you are a doer. And I promise I'll be here every week to support you and remind you that you can be a profitable musician.